Welcome to Complete in Him. I'm your host, Evangelist Edward Barmonte. And we're going to be picking up with where we left off in our series. We're talking about prayer warriors, mighty men and women of God who did great exploits for God. And at this point, we're going to be talking about an amazing guy who did exploits of faith, exploits of proclamation, and exploits of prayer. And the person that we're talking about is the warrior shepherd boy, okay, who became king, a man after God's own heart, King David, the king of Israel. Okay, now, we're going to be picking up in 1 Samuel 15, 18. And what we're going to notice here is that Saul, okay, if you read this, you can follow along in your Bible. We're not going to cover the whole scripture because if we did that, it would take forever. But I'm going to go ahead, and if you'll notice up in that corner, I'm going to put the scripture where it's at so that you can read it, follow along if you like to, or you can actually look it up later and be blessed. Because you know what? Everything in the Word of God will bless you because it's the Word of God. Okay. So what we're going to notice is that in chapter 15, you know, King Saul was given the kingdom of Israel, and he was anointed to be king, and with that came great responsibility to be obedient to God's prophet and who was giving him the word of God, okay? And Samuel went to him and said, hey, you got to do this thing, but you have to do it this way. And when Saul went to do what he was asked to do, he was disobedient. And because of his disobedience, okay, God ripped that kingdom out of his grasp, okay? Now, he didn't rip him immediately off the throne, okay? But what he did do was take the kingdom of Israel from his family as a legacy and gave it unto another, okay? Now, the person that he gave it to was a young shepherd boy, all right? And because that young shepherd boy could not be king, did not have the understanding, it didn't matter. God knew him, knew his heart, knew what he was going to do and the exploits, but most importantly, he knew his heart, okay? Because David was out tending sheep, singing and praising and worshiping God while he was doing that, okay? He had built a great relationship with the Lord. And from that great relationship of abiding with God, okay, God blessed him. And blessed him as king over Israel. Now, in chapter 16, verse 13, it tells us where and how Samuel anointed the shepherd boy to be king. Now, with that anointing, you know, even today in our lives, God will bless us. He'll bless us with a vision. He'll bless us with a mighty word that blesses our hearts. But those blessings many times are like in David's life, an anointing of beginning. It's an anointing where seeds, the seed of the word, the seed of the gift is placed within us. And over time, God is blessing and germinating those seeds so that they will rise up and flourish in the appointed time under his anointing. Okay, it's very important to understand that because, you know, a lot of people will, you know, will say, hey, Samuel anointed David with oil to be king. Why couldn't he be king? Well, he was just a boy. And there are many things that he had to learn. And there were things that God had to bring him through before placing him into that headship position. Okay. All right. Now, also 16:18, the word of God says that God favored David. David was highly favored of God. What does that mean? God's blessing was on David. But there were times in David's life where you would think, where is God? You know, David, there were many times when he cried out in the middle of a cave because he was running away for his life. Hey, where is my God? Where's all the flourishing, you know, that is supposed to come with this anointing? Actually, it was there, but it was something that he did not realize until later. Okay? All right, now. Also, in 1622, we know that God favored David because God gave him position, and the gifts that were in David's life, okay, at that time would be the gifts that David would use in a greater way going forward in his life. Does that mean that God only uses those specific things? Absolutely not. Absolutely not, because we have giftings by God that we don't even understand. And that's why Jesus said, you know, you have to abide in me. In John chapter 15, 14, 15, 16, you have to abide in me, because apart from me, you can do nothing. You know, when we abide in the Lord, spend time with God, spend time with His Word, spend time in prayer, spend time in His presence, resting and listening to the very small voice of God, that's the abiding. And that's where God blesses us. That's where He changes us. That's where He challenges us. That's where He gifts us. That's where He waters the seeds. Okay? It is those prayers, the special times of faith and presence, where God blesses us. Okay. Now, we also know that David stayed faithful according to who David was. Now, we know later in life that he blew it, but what did he do when he blew it? He immediately cried out to God and put his trust in God. The difference between David and Saul is David had a purposeful relationship with God. And my readings of Saul, it shows that Saul always asked for others to cry out to the God of Israel for him. But David didn't do that. David cried out to God himself, okay? Sang songs to God, prayed to God. He was just a totally different dude, all right? Now, if there's somebody that you want to be like, it's obviously King David. You want to have that special relationship, and you want your ministry, your life, from this point going forward, built on that very special relationship of abiding with God. Because our destinies are made complete in Him, by Him, through Him, for Him, unto His glory. So you want to have, you know, just get that locked into your heart and spend as much time as you can with God in prayer. Amen? Amen. Okay, now, during that time when David was anointed, he went and he continued to do the things that God wanted him to do. We know that God did not immediately, even though that God pulled the kingdom of Israel from Saul's legacy, God did not pull Saul immediately from the throne, okay? Because God was preparing his servant, okay, the successor to King Saul. All right. So during that time that David was being groomed, let's say, by the Holy Spirit, growing up to become a man, the Philistines. Now, the Philistines were Greek marauders, okay? They were actually from the Greek islands, and they came to, obviously, conquer lands. And they were there specifically to conquer land. And what happened was they came up against the army of Israel. And we know that Saul and the army of Israel met the Philistines in the battle to fight for the land, okay? Now, during that time, Jesse called out to his son David and said, hey, I want you to take these provisions down to your brothers who are down with King Saul, you know, doing battle against the Philistines. I want you to bring these provisions to them and be a blessing. So right there, we know that God blessed Jesse, the house of Jesse, blessed David to be a blessing unto others by sending provisions to those who were supposedly doing battle against God's enemies or the enemies of Israel. Now, when David got there, he didn't see any battle. He saw a bunch of guys over here and a bunch of guys on the other side of what was probably a line drawn in the sand, okay? And every day, it says in the Bible, that this one huge Philistine from Gath, all right, his name was Goliath, and basically he would come out, the champion of the Philistines, and he would taunt the army of Israel. Now, this guy was huge, and, you know, back then, there weren't a whole lot of people 8 feet tall. Okay, and this guy had on massive armor, you know, things could not penetrate the armor, and he had this huge sword so that when he swung it, people could not get close to him because his sword was so long, okay? And so, you know, people were afraid. Guys were afraid to go up against this guy because anybody who tried died. Okay. So when Saul came out, the army of Israel, they fled. All right. Now, the only other time that I can see, well, it's not the only other time, but, you know, it kind of just popped into my heart and in my mind that in years past, Israel kind of did the same thing. You know, God said, hey, I'm going to send spies to check out the land, okay? And they did. When the spies came back, there were spies like Joshua who said, hey, we can do this. The fruit is amazing. It is wonderful. It is surely a land of blessing and of milk and honey. We can go, and we, in the power and the anointing of God, we can do this great thing. But there were others that went that said, hey, whoa, hey, you know, there's giants in the land. There's giants. They'll kill us. We can't go up against these people. Are you kidding us? Well, you know what? God did not bless those people. But God did bless Joshua, the son of Nun, to be the leader over Israel because he trusted in the Lord his God. And if there's any lesson that we need to learn right from the very start of understanding what a prayer warrior is that we have to put our hope and our trust completely in the Lord our God, okay? We must pray believing that God will bless the one who is praying. For the prayer of the righteous, O God, availeth much in the eyes of God. The prayers of the righteous availeth much in the eyes of God, okay? So in the ears of God. So what we have to do is we have to come before God praying and believing that he is the rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And I gotta be honest with you, if we're praying in the Holy Spirit and if we're praying the word of God and if we're praying what God wants us to pray, God is gonna bless it. He's gonna bless it, he's gonna bless it, he's gonna bless it. So pray believing that God is gonna bring it to pass because he calls those things which are not as though they are, okay? We must approach God by faith if we desire to please him. We must believe that God is who he says he is and that he will do what he says he will do, okay? Amen. All right, so from that premise, that is how we become a mighty prayer warrior. That is the premise that David used when he went out to face Goliath. That is the premise that Joshua used when he came back from the land of milk and honey and told Moses how amazing it was. That is the premise that Abraham used. That is the premise that Elijah used when he went up against the prophets of Baal and the evil woman at the time, Jezebel. Okay, he trusted, they trusted in the Lord their God. And we must approach the throne of grace with the same power, believing that God is the rewarder of those who pursue him. Amen? Amen. Now, we who are in Christ, okay, Paul says, we are even more powerful. How can we be more powerful? Because we have the Holy Spirit. Paul said, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty and powerful in the Holy Spirit to the pulling down of strongholds and fortresses unto the glory of the living God. Okay? Right there. We have the Holy Spirit because of what Jesus did for us. We are anointed to pray. We are anointed and powerful in the Holy Spirit to pray, to be a prayer warrior, to go to God believing he is and he is the rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And if we pray anointed of the Holy Spirit, led of the Holy Spirit, praying the will of God that we might not pray amiss, God will answer our prayers and he will heal our land. And that is a blessing, and that is a promise from the word of God unto you this day. Okay, back to David. All right. So there he was, Goliath, okay, taunting Israel. And here's this little guy, shepherd boy, and says, who is this guy, this uncircumcised Philistine, taunting the army of the living God? Well, hey, like I said, fear empowered by grace. Fear? Who is this guy who thinks he could come up against God? empowered by the Holy Spirit and grace. Fear, running away. Child of God, believing. So Goliath called out, "Hey, send out your champion. Send out somebody to face me. If he beats me, you win. You get everything. If I beat him, we win. We take everything." Well, we know from the promises of the Word of God that Israel was in God's hand, and it was specifically for the people of Israel. We know that God was going to bless his promised people with his promise of land and blessing, because that's who he is. God is the God of his word. He is a God of blessing. His word never fails. It accomplishes that which he has sent it forth to do. God is a creator. You know, he could have at that moment struck the Philistines like that, but he didn't. But what he did, though, is use a small shepherd boy to confront a giant of a man, a giant of an issue, okay? And there seems to be so many giants, so many issues, so many giants in the land today, and so many people are so filled with fear. And if they are in Christ, there's no reason. God did not give us a spirit of fear, but he gave us a spirit of love, power, and peace of mind. For the kingdom of heaven is righteousness, peace, and joy. That's who our God is. A God of power, a God of might, a God of anointing, a God of love, a God of grace, and a God of purpose. And his purpose is for you this very day to rise up in faith, believing, praying the prayer of faith unto a mighty Father who loves you because he sent his only begotten Son, Jesus. Amen? Amen. Okay. So there we have it. Saul taunting the army of Israel, taunting the king of Israel. And next, what we're going to understand is David said, "Hey, you, big dude with the ugly shoes and the crazy looking armor, I'm going to fight you today." And the people laughed. It says it in the Word of God, and they laughed. Here it is. The Philistines were challenging Israel through Goliath in 1 Samuel 17:24. The fear that kept Israel from entering into the promised land of God came upon them and they ran away. But David, anointed of God, stands firm and resolute. 1 Samuel 17, verse 26. "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should touch or taunt the armies of the living God?" Okay. Doubters. Doubters, oh my gosh, the same people that fled from the giant, the same people that fled from going into the land of blessing and promise, seem to be the same people that, you know, it's like they were reincarnated or something, you know, and they're just saying, "David, what are you, stupid? You can't do this. You're just a little shepherd boy. He's a mighty warrior who's 8 feet tall. He's twice your size, David. You can't do this. He's twice your weight." So what they did, they just kept speaking those words of doubt. Doubt, doubt, doubt. What did David do? He rebuked them. Okay? He said, "Hey, I can do this." Where did it come from? You got to ask yourself, this little guy, the shepherd boy, looking at this huge guy, where did that intestinal fortitude come from? Well, it came from the anointing of the living God that was upon David's life. Okay? He trusted God. He believed God. He trusted God. Amen? Amen. Okay, now, what we're going to see is that David accepts the challenge to fight for Israel in 1 Samuel 17:32. All right? Now, as soon as he does that, more negativity, more negative speech. Okay, and you can find that in 1733. And then David's response. "I have fought lions and bears in the wilderness to protect the flock that I shepherd. I will kill this Philistine today. Wow. And that's in verse 17, 34, 36. Now, here you have this little guy going up against this big guy. I am going to kill this big guy today. Again, the anointing of the living God, that seed, that anointing that was in him, welled up within him. And the anointing and the power of the presence of God, the Holy Spirit, that gift, that anointing, it's like it came alive at that point. And he said, as I have done unto the flock, so shall I do this day. It was almost as if God was showing Israel that a king is like a shepherd. And that a shepherd is like a king over the flock. Wow. How's that for a little bit of an insight, okay? All right. But there it was, a shepherd boy fighting to protect his flock. A king fighting to protect the children of Israel under the anointing of the living God. That kingship anointing that was placed upon his life came alive. It came alive into its purpose. And its purpose was to be there that day at that time to destroy that enemy. That same anointing of the Holy Spirit abides when in us, that we can rise up in the power of the Holy Spirit and pray the prayer of faith, believing that God will move by his power in Jesus' name and do the will that he has spoken forward. Amen and amen. Now, I want to clarify that every prayer that we pray is not the will of God, because the Bible says in James that we can pray amiss. But let me tell you something. If God moves upon your heart to pray a prayer of faith, believing, that comes specifically out of his word, that is specifically to edify, to build, and to benefit the body of Christ according to the will and the word of God, I guarantee you 100% that anointed prayer of the Holy Spirit is going to accomplish that which God sent it forward to do. He sent it forward into your heart to speak it and to proclaim it, to pray the prayer of faith, believing, so that he could say, that's my kid praying my will. That which I specifically have ordained at this specific point in time is going to come to pass because of that child's obedience, praying the prayer of faith, standing in the gap and fighting in prayer for the body of Christ and for the salvation of the world. Pretty powerful. You kind of see that? You see how that all comes about? Shepherd boy, singing and worshiping, abiding in God, praising and worshiping God out in the field. The sheep, no one hears his voice, they're at peace. An enemy comes in and that shepherd boy rises up and battles and protects the flock. That shepherd boy is anointed to be king over Israel. Okay, a lion and a bear and an evil man and people that had no right to the land of Israel come to maraud and to take the blessing of God away from the children. Papa wasn't going to allow that. And to show himself strong, just as he did against Baal and the prophets of Jezebel and Baal, he's going to show himself strong today. And he did. So what does the Bible say? Verse 32, 17, 32, David accepts the challenge. More negativity, 17, 33. And then David's response, 17, 34, 36. Okay? But David put his trust in God, 17, 37. And the proclamation of that faith, of that anointing, that seed to be the king over Israel, welled up within him. And he said, the Lord my God will deliver me today, and he will deliver Israel from their enemy. And that's exactly what happened. Saul offers, you know, obviously when he did this, King Saul's like, what? What? Let me see this little guy. So they bring him in, and there's King Saul in his pomp and his circumstance. And he's like, hey, dude, you're really going to do this? But you're so little. And he's like, yeah, I'm going to do this for Israel. I'm going to do this for God and to the glory of my God. And so, Saul's like, well, okay, if you're going to do this, okay, here, I want you to take my armor and take my sword. And you know, Saul was a tall guy. He was, it says, head and shoulders above all the others. He was very handsome, head and shoulders above all the others in Israel. Okay, so the Israelis, they were kind of short people. All right, so what he does is he puts on Saul's armor, David puts on Saul's armor, and he's like, you know, it's just swimming in this armor. I mean, it doesn't fit him, it's too big. He's probably never handled a sword before in his life. He doesn't know how to use the shield, and you know, he wasn't trained that way. He was a shepherd, trained of God, and there were specific things that God blessed him with, okay? All right, so now, like I said, it doesn't matter that at that particular time in his life, David did not know how to use a sword or shield the way that a trained warrior would, because we know that later on that David actually became that trained warrior and slew many, many, many adversaries of the people of Israel. Okay, so that shows us that even though there's this other gift, that, you know, those dormant other gifts and other talents, they'll come alive in the anointing of the Holy Spirit. You might not think they're there, but if God has called you to do something, I guarantee you those things are there. He has anointed those things and they are going to come to life. Okay? Just like the anointing came alive in David's life, they're going to come alive in your life as well. Okay? So don't give up. Stand firm. Be a David. Stand firm. Okay? Put your hope and your trust in the Lord thy God and you will not be dismayed. Okay, so Saul, all right, in 1739 gives David advice, but David says, hey, no thanks, verse 40, I can't use this, you know, I don't know, I just can't use this, it doesn't fit me, it doesn't feel right, I just can't use this. So what does he do? He relies on what the Lord spoke to him and put into his life, okay? He relied upon the things that were him, okay? Trusting in God and using the things that he used as the shepherd over his sheep, who was to be the shepherd and the king over Israel. All right. So he basically goes out there and stands before Goliath, and Goliath taunts him and says, hey, little dude, you don't want to come up against this, okay? 1744. You don't want any part of this. Do you see? You don't want this. And David's looking at him and it's like, dude, you have no clue what's about to hit you upside your big head this day. All right? You, big-headed dude, 8 feet tall. If that's all you got nothing, man. Okay. Here's what you need to know. I came to battle you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel. And this day, this very day, enemy of God, he will deliver you to me. You will die, and I will cut off your head. The birds and the beasts of the fields will eat yours, and the Philistines' flesh and bones this very day. It was a proclamation of faith unto the glory of God, so that they will know that God is God in Israel. He said, I have come to you to do battle against you in the name and for the glory of the God of Israel. And that needs to be the premise of our prayer. That must be the premise of the prayer warrior. That is the very premise that we are anointed to do exploits. We are anointed to do exploits for the living God unto the glory of his beloved Son, in whom perished and has given us eternal life, who was risen and is seated at the right hand of God to judge the living and the dead. All that we do and are called to do are for his glory and his anointing by his Holy Spirit and the promises through the word of God. And that is why we pray by faith, believing in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. The proclamation of faith and glory to God. Verse 47. So the world will know there is a God in Israel. So the world will know there is a God on the face of the earth today, there is a God who is above all and mighty and powerful. And his name is Jesus. His name is Holy Spirit. His name is God Almighty, Abba Father, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the mighty Trinity. So the world will know this day that there is a God above all. He is the creator of the universe. He will show himself strong in the midst of his children this very day. And therefore, I pray the prayer of faith, believing, call upon the one true living God in the name of Jesus, anointed of the Holy Spirit, that he will do this today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The prayer and the foundation of the prayer warrior of the living God. So the world will know there is a God in Israel. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you, Goliath, and all the Philistines, Goliath, into our hands. All right. How much more powerful, as I've been trying to explain, are we in the body of Christ? How much more powerful are we? Jesus said, and John, it's this promise of the abiding, that if he goes unto the Father, which was the promise, that we would do greater things than what he did when he walked the face of the earth. That's his promise. Greater things than these shall you do if I go unto my heavenly Father. And we have seen that. We have seen just mighty, powerful moves and works by the Holy Spirit unto God's glory. Not of man, not of flesh, not of earthly, fleshly weapons, but of God, created by God, ordained of God, proclaimed to the glory of God, to glorify God. Amen? Amen. We must approach the enemies of God in prayerful resolve that he would fight our battles for his glory. Okay? God is always victorious. We must pray believing, for our hope and trust is in the Lord our God, in whom we place our boast. Amen? But what did he do? He took a sling that was made of sheepskin. He picked up 5 smooth stones from a brook, placed them into his bag, took one of those stones, put it into that sheepskin. This is what he used as a shepherd boy. And when he went up against Goliath, he did what he knew and knew very well to do in defeating bears and lions. He swung it and he threw that stone, hitting Goliath right in the head, knocking him down. I mean, he went out, boom. It's just like, boom, just like, shoo, wham, boom, out for the count, okay? And what David did, as he promised unto the glory of God, went over, took Goliath's huge sword, okay, and cut off that giant's head, okay? The Philistines were freaked. You know, they ran because their earthly hope had been destroyed. But the army of Israel, because of God Almighty, God's mercy, power, and grace, who showed himself strong that day, well, they conquered the Philistines. They defeated them. And as promised, their bones were left for the beasts of the field and the birds of the air to consume them. You know, we have to pray those that same way. We have to be like David. We have to approach God with such tenacity, with such forceful proclamation, with such faith, believing in our Father who is. I mean, he is amazing. Our God, our Papa, our Abba is amazing, okay? And he sent his Son, who loves us so much. God and Jesus, they both love us so much. They're so amazing. And Jesus died for us so that we could have life and have life more abundantly. Eternal life, because, you know, he suffered the cross. Now he's in heaven. He was resurrected. Our Savior, our God, he blesses us with the Holy Spirit to do great and mighty exploits. But we have to approach it like David to defeat the Goliaths in our land today. I want to encourage you, whatever it is that you're facing today, if you would pray the prayer of faith, believing according to the Word of God, whether it's healing, okay? God is our healer. It's his promise. He promised this in Psalms and Isaiah. You know, he's our healer. He heals. He will heal you. Whatever it is, he'll heal your heart, mind, soul, spirit, body. Whatever it is, he will heal you and restore you. Because that's his will. That's part of who he is. He is a merciful, loving, holy God. He is a provider and a healer. He will heal you today. Whatever it is that you need, if you pray according to the Word of God, God will bless you. Now, this you could take to the bank. Jesus said, I'm going to send you the Comforter. I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will lead you into all truth. Now, that was a very profound statement. And here's why. Because if you don't know how to pray believing, the Holy Spirit will teach you. If you don't know where to find the words of grace to help you specifically in your time of need, according to what God has for your life, the Holy Spirit will lead you. He'll show you. He'll show you the Word of God. And the Holy Spirit will help you pray. We who are blessed in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you know, when I pray and I ask the Holy Spirit, please lead me into revelation so that I do not pray amiss, that I might glorify you to this day through obedience and truth. So that which I pray will, O God, move heaven to bless us on earth. I want to pray the will of God, all right? But sometimes there's issues and there's things where I need to specifically trust God because I might not be able to find that specific right example. But I will pray, Holy Spirit, lead me, lead my prayer, my spiritual prayer, okay, in truth, so that I can receive the blessing of God because I did not pray amiss, that I might pray unto his glory, the prayer of faith, believing that this will be accomplished in Jesus' name. Do you know that the Holy Spirit, he'll put words into my mouth to pray? And I will pray in the Holy Spirit. I will pray in tongues. Okay, in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, receiving the gift of tongues, I will pray in tongues, and I will pray believing, because the Holy Spirit cannot lead one amiss. He's God. So if you ask the Holy Spirit what to pray, you're asking God to pray prayers that are pleasing to him. And of course, he's going to bless that because it's his specific will for your life and for the life of others today. So pray the prayer of faith, believing. Trust God in everything that you do, in everything that you pray for, in Jesus' name. I hope this blesses you today. The boy, the shepherd boy, prayer warrior, shepherd king, blessing of God, edifying and building up the people unto God's glory. Amen. God bless you today. Shalom.